On the first films, I purposely avoided very intense design cultures. So I kept the costumes very, very simple, and costumes were designed not to draw attention to themselves. In the new film, the costumes do draw attention to themselves. They have to, because they're in a more sophisticated society. And to do that and keep it timeless is much more difficult.
I think with respect to episode one, it became pretty clear immediately that these were costumes that we weren't going to be able to rent or hire from any place around the world. And the only way we're going to maintain the quality and have the look, the true look that we wanted, was to fabricate everything.
At our busiest, we were using maybe 50, 60 people just in the costume department. I think we need well over 1,000 costumes. In fact, we need everything, really, that's seen, everything, hats, helmets, costumes. We had fabrics woven, printed, dyed. Everything that you could do to a piece of fabric, we have done to it.
When I initially saw the designs, I was like, wow, I have to do this, because you could see how much, there's so much more that goes into it than just a regular movie. You feel that the movie's really a creation. It's a lot of artists coming together and working on it. It's not just, you know, a script and a couple of actors.
It was extraordinary to stand in front of the mirror with all my wardrobe on and stuff. Because I was Obi-Wan Kenobi, you know, and it was quite a moment for a young man.
You still have much to learn, my young apprentice.
The look of the costumes, like, taps into all these various cultures that we all subliminally recognize.
The designs are a little more outlandish, especially for the Queen. We looked all over, from Mongolia, Tibet, and just everywhere to find inspiration for our costumes.
This is where we're going to get killed the most, or I'm going to get killed. I have very scrupulously avoided fashion in the other movies. I made the Princess Leia, you know, very, very simple, just completely simple. No design, no fashion, no nothing. This time we're walking right into a fashion statement. Head on.
When I first started in the film, we were going to have 3 costumes for the Queen. And as time went on, George decided that every time we saw the Queen, that she was going to have a different costume.
Somebody of that stature would automatically be changing her costumes to fit the occasion. She travels, she goes to the Senate, she has sort of official functions and non-official functions, and each one of those demands a different type of costume.
Ian McKay did a lot of the drawing, and various other people in the conceptual art department, and sort of showed them to George at the art department meetings, and then, you know, came back and said, yes, George likes this one, doesn't like that one.
Some suggestions for some of the new
ones. If you could make that line more...
You basically take the screenplay and the written word, if you get to read it, or a verbal description from the director, if you don't, and imagine it.
Has a little loop on the side of her trousers for the gun belt to be held down there.
The ski pant outfit. You know, it's one thing to be able to draw something on a piece of paper and another thing to actually make it three-dimensional and work. But Tricia couldn't do that. She had to actually deal with it and make it work in the real world.
I think you quite like the idea of being able to see through it. Yeah, I think 4 inches on the center backs.
So there was a lot of redesigning that had to go on. So this is red. And a lot of working with different types of fabrics, pretty intense, different kinds of materials, different kinds of jewelry, and make it all fit together.
4 1/4 inches across. So was that marked the center or?
Yeah.
I went to London and discovered what a real costume designer does, which is take 20 different fabrics, go, and next thing you know, there they all are, and they're pinned up, and it's a sheet of black just like you drew, but it's, you know, 10 different pieces of material.
This is the part of the Queen Travel One costume. It's completely handmade, so you start with a sheet of almost clear, it's like a cellophane. You do your design on it, and when you finish that, you stick it in water, and the clear fabric disappears, leaving the lace. So this fabric took someone probably a month to me working at continually.
It will be ratified by the Senate.
I will not.
We use quite a lot of antique pieces in various places, antique trimming and fabrics from various parts of the world. This, I think, probably was about 1910. But it was quite difficult to tell just because it was a lace piece with sort of odd bits. Some of the motifs weren't complete, so we had some fantastic sort of embroiderers here who managed to bead it all back and add in the beads to make it look like one complete piece.
Tricia is very good at bringing in antique cloths, various kinds of weights of cloth that would move different ways when they were layered on top of each other, things that I hadn't had a lot of experience with, and so I learned a great deal from Tricia.
This was quite a time-consuming fabric to create because all the stones were gathered sort of on a beach. We did have problems with this in Tunisia because with the heat, the rubber sort of expanded slightly and we had stones popping out all over the place and spent quite a lot of time having to put them back in again.
I thought that collar was meant to be slightly set back, but that's quite flexible, isn't it?
That is a smaller piece and then have another piece here, depending on how fat to go underneath.
It's very easy in a movie to want to make everybody be the same because then you can just replicate a particular costume.
We've done two versions of this armour in different types of quilting.
To do individual costumes and do them in the thousands is a very, very difficult task. But I did want the military to have several different kinds of outfits, that the officers were different than the enlisted men, that the pilots were different than the troopers.
I'm going to say you've got a belt.
Yep.
You've got gloves. That thing on your head is perhaps a hat.
Goggles and boots.
Well, being in the costumes themselves and having the strange makeup and hair really made me feel different. You feel like a different person. When you feel like a different person, it's easier to act like a different person. It also changes your movement. If you've got a big thing on your head, you have to walk straighter. You can't slouch like an American teenager. You have to stand straight like a queen so that it doesn't knock you over.
In the other films I've been involved with, it's always been a very, very simple wardrobe. And this became a very complex, very designed wardrobe, a very fashionable wardrobe.
I think people will be amazed by the costume. The images are so haunting and so beautiful. And I think it's something that they've never seen or witnessed before in any previous Star Wars film.
I just think the great costumes. I think Ewan looks fantastic in his.
You look good in yours. You look fantastic.
It's good for like the effect of the film. As long as it doesn't like give me brain damage or anything, I'm all for it.
On the first films, I purposely avoided very intense design cultures. So I kept the costumes very, very simple, and the costumes were designed not to draw attention to themselves. In the new film, the costumes do draw attention to themselves. They have to, because they're in a more sophisticated society. And to do that and keep it timeless is much more difficult.
I think with respect to episode one, it became pretty clear immediately that these were costumes that we weren't going to be able to rent or hire from any place around the world. And the only way we're going to maintain the quality and have the look, the true look that we wanted, was to fabricate everything.
At our busiest, we were using maybe 50, 60 people just in the costume department. I think we made well over 1,000 costumes. In fact, we made everything really that's seen, everything, hats, helmets, costumes. We had fabrics woven, printed, dyed. Everything that you could do to a piece of fabric, we have done to it.
When I initially saw the designs, I was like, wow, I have to do this, because you could see how much, there's so much more that goes into it than just a regular movie. You feel that the movie's really a creation. It's a lot of artists coming together and working on it. It's not just, you know, a script and a couple of actors.
It was extraordinary to stand in front of the mirror with all my wardrobe on and stuff. Because I was Obi-Wan Kenobi, you know, and it was quite a moment for a young man.
You still have much to learn, my young apprentice.
The look of the costumes, like, taps into all these various cultures that we all subliminally recognize.
The designs are a little more outlandish, especially for the Queen. We looked all over, from Mongolia, Tibet, and just everywhere to find inspiration for our costumes.
This is where we're going to get killed the most, or I'm going to get killed. I have very scrupulously avoided fashion in the other movies. I made the Princess Leia, you know, very, very simple, just completely simple. No design, no fashion, no nothing. This time we're walking right into a fashion statement. Head on.
When I first started in the film, we were going to have three costumes for the Queen. And as time went on, George decided that every time we saw the Queen, that she was going to have a different costume.
Somebody of that stature would automatically be changing her costumes to fit the occasion. She travels, she goes to the Senate, she has sort of official functions and non-official functions, and each one of those demands a different type of costume.
Ian McCaig did a lot of the drawing, and various other people in the conceptual art department, and sort of showed them to George at the art department meetings, and then, you know, came back and said, yes, George likes this one, doesn't like that one.
Some suggestions for some of the new costumes.
Ooh! If you could make that line more...
You basically take the screenplay and the written word, if you get to read it, or a verbal description from the director, if you don't, and imagine it.
Has a little loop on the side of her trousers for the gun belt to be held down there.
A ski pant outfit.
You know, it's one thing to be able to draw something on a piece of paper and another thing to actually make it three-dimensional and work. But Tricia couldn't do that. She had to actually deal with it and make it work in the real world.
I think you quite like the idea of being able to see through it. Yeah, I think 4 inches on the centerpiece.
So there was a lot of redesigning that had to go on. So this is red. A lot of working with different types of fabrics, pretty intense, different kinds of materials, different kinds of jewelry, and make it all fit together.
4¼ inches across. So
was that
mark the center or?
Yeah. I went to London and discovered what a real costume designer does, which is take 20 different fabrics, go, and next thing you know, there they all are, and they're pinned up, and it's a sheet of black just like you drew, but it's, you know, 10 different pieces of material.
This is the part of the Queen Travel One costume. It's completely handmade, so you start with a sheet of almost clear, it's like a cellophane. You do your design on it, and when you finish that, you stick it in water, and the clear fabric disappears, leaving the lace. So this fabric took someone probably a month to make, working at continually.
It will be ratified by the Senate.
I will know.
We use quite a lot of antique pieces in various places, antique trimming and fabrics from various parts of the world. This, I think, probably was about 1910. But it was quite difficult to tell just because it was a lace piece with sort of odd bits. Some of the motifs weren't complete, so we had some fantastic sort of embroiderers here who managed to bead it all back and add in the beads to make it look like one complete piece.
Tricia is very good at bringing in antique cloths, various kinds of weights of cloth that would move different ways when they were layered on top of each other, things that I hadn't had a lot of experience with, and so I learned a great deal from Tricia.
This was quite a time-consuming fabric to create, because all the stones were gathered sort of on a beach. We did have problems with this in Tunisia, because with the heat, the rubber sort of expanded slightly, and we had stones popping out all over the place, and spent quite a lot of time having to put them back in again.
I thought that corner was meant to be slightly set back.
That's quite flexible, isn't it?
That's a smaller piece, and then put another piece here, depending on how fat to go underneath.
It's very easy in a movie to want to make everybody be the same, because then you can just replicate a particular costume.
We've done two versions of this armor in different types of quilting.
To do individual costumes and do them in the thousands is a very, very difficult task. But I did want the
the military to have several different kinds of outfits, that the officers were different than the enlisted men, that the pilots were different than the troopers.
I'm going to say you've got a belt.
Yeah, you got gloves.
That thing on your head is perhaps a hat.
Goggles and boots.
Well, being in the costumes themselves and having the strange makeup and hair really made me feel different. You feel like a different person. When you feel like a different person, it's easier to act like a different person. It also changes your movement. If you've got a big thing on your head, you have to walk straighter. You can't slouch like an American teenager. You have to stand straight like a queen so that it doesn't knock you over.
In the other films I've been involved with, it's always been a very, very simple wardrobe. And this became a very complex, very designed wardrobe, very fashionable wardrobe.
I think people will be amazed by the costume. The images are so haunting and so beautiful. And I think it's something that they've never seen or witnessed before in any previous Star Wars film.
I just think that the gray costumes, I think Ewan looks fantastic in his.
You look good in yours. You look fantastic.
It's good for like the effect of the film, as long as it doesn't like give me brain damage or anything, I'm all for it.
So on the first films, I purposely avoided very intense design cultures because I had enough to do without trying to come up with something that would be timeless. So I kept the costumes very, very simple, and the costumes were designed not to draw attention to themselves. In the new film, the costumes do draw attention to themselves. They have to because they're in a more sophisticated society. To do that, and keep it timeless is much more difficult. Tricia is very good at bringing in antique cloths, various kinds of weights of cloth that would move different ways when they were layered on top of each other, things that I hadn't had a lot of experience with. And so I learned a great deal from Tricia about that whole aspect of fashion design that I enjoyed playing with. You know, it's one thing to be able to draw something on a piece of paper and another thing to actually make it three-dimensional and work in the real world. The issues of fabrics, style of fabrics, the weight of fabrics, the way fabrics move when a person moves, these are all issues that come into play when you start actually trying to make these designs real. It becomes very complex because the artist sometimes will cheat in, would get into a particular problem with a particular part of the costume, and he just sort of scribble around it, and but Tricia couldn't do that. She had to actually deal with it and make it work in the real world. So there was a lot of redesigning that had to go on, a lot of working with various different types of fabrics, different kinds of jewelry, different kinds of materials to make helmets and hair pieces and that sort of thing, and make it all fit together. It seems extremely appropriate that when you have a queen that she would be changing outfits. The film takes place over a period of time, and somebody of that stature would automatically be changing her costumes to fit the occasion. She travels, she goes to the Senate, she is in various, she has sort of official functions and non-official functions, and each one of those demanded a different type of costume, which meant that she had a very large wardrobe. It's very easy in a movie to want to make everybody be the same, because then you can just replicate a particular costume. To do individual costumes and do them in the thousands is a very, very difficult task. But I did want the military to have, you know, several different kinds of outfits, that the officers were different than the enlisted men, that the pilots were different than the troopers. And we tried to get a variety, even in the military, of various kinds of costumes. In the other films I've been involved with, it's always been a very, very simple wardrobe. And this became a very complex, very designed wardrobe, a very fashionable wardrobe. How strong a costume is and how much it will wear is very important. And we were very careful to make sure that the costumes were not going to fall apart on the set, because some of them were very intricate. And I think we never really did have to wait for a costume that was constantly falling apart or something. Because whenever you make a movie, you learn real fast that props and costumes, if they're delicate at all, are going to cause you a huge amount of trouble and cost you a lot of time. Well, it's when you get into the more sophisticated societies, we had to come up with a design that would fit into that culture and would reflect the culture itself. So you'll see in Naboo, there's a lot of greens and blues and soft colors. The green, the queen is very much in reds and yellows and blacks. We wanted to set her apart from the overall look of the general population, and then work with a color that we could set apart from her handmaidens so that they would accent her in a particular kind of way. There was a lot of larger design work that was done with particularly the queen and how she fit into her environment and how she was separate from the overall population and the way the culture looked. The costumes in any kind of film are very important in defining the character and defining the culture, in making things feel realistic. So the costumes are a very integral part in the overall design of the film. And the design really includes the photography, the sets, and the costumes, and the props. So these elements all come together to create an atmosphere or a reality for the audience. And if they aren't right, then the audience isn't going to be in the picture.
There wasn't really a moment where George came to me about the costumes, but the evolutionary way in which we started to work on the costumes up in the art department, when we were really going through the conceptual stage, it became pretty clear immediately that these were costumes that we weren't going to be able to rent or hire from any place around the world. And at that point, that really wasn't a major issue for me. I wanted to let everybody feel free to be able to really express themselves. And as the costumes got wilder and wilder, it just became really a logistical issue about how we were going to try and approach them. I knew we were going to have to make them. I knew there was only one person to make them, and that was Tricia Bigger, who we worked with very successfully on the Young Indiana Jones Chronicles. But she was the only person that I knew that would be able to actually do it within the time and do it with the money that we had. I think with respect to episode one of the prequels, I think people will be amazed by the costumes. I think they'll be stunned. The images are so haunting and so beautiful. And I think it's something that they've never seen or witnessed before in any previous Star Wars film. Ian McKaig, who is our concept costume designer, our conceptual designer, started working on sketches. And he'd get a book, you know, I'd get him a book on Mongolia. Mongolian costumes or Moroccan costumes or costumes from, you know, different cultures. He'd start to look through them, and then he'd start to synthesize that, some of the more powerful images that he saw, and start to work and elaborate them. Then George would come in, and he'd say, God, you know, I love this hat, and I like the idea of this sleeve, but I'm not happy with the main fabric of this. Can you change it a little bit? And then he would make those changes. And that process took about 6 or 7 months. And then about really about a year into it, I thought, this is the time to have Tricia come in to the ranch and actually start to work with Ian and start to figure out what was really practical, what we could really actually get. And then once she came in, she added a whole other spin to it. And her and George immediately saw not only the characters, but the way they should start to look together. Then, as she would have an idea, Ian would readdress a certain aspect of the costume to fit in with the character. So it was a very interesting process, and it lasted a long time, but it was a very crucial part of the movie for us. I'd say overall we spent almost 18 months working out what the costumes would look like. I mean, George was very, very focused on the detail of every costume and every change that the Queen would go through. But in addition to that, we had another 1,000 costumes to design. and a 60 principal actors had to have a special look. They all came from different planets, and he really gets into the detail of that. There's very little of those costumes that aren't directly influenced by him in one way or another. Well, she is queen. She is a queen. Number one, she's very regal. We're dealing with a very young woman who has become a queen, and it was important to immediately position her, immediately have a symbol of her strength and her character. And part of the way in which you do that is the clothes that she wears. I mean, not too dissimilar from any other king or queen that exists in the world today.
At our busiest, we were using maybe 50, 60 people just in the costume department. And I think we made well over 1,000 costumes. In fact, we made everything, really, that's seen, everything, hats, helmets, costumes, so huge, huge amounts. And we created fabrics. We had fabrics woven, printed, dyed, various techniques, devoured, everything that you could do to a piece of fabric, we have done to it. Ian McCaig did a lot of the drawing, and various other people in the conceptual art department did the drawings, really, and sort of showed them to George at the art department meetings, and then, you know, came back and said, yes, George likes this one, doesn't like that one. When I first started in the film, we were going to have 3 costumes for the Queen. And as time went on, it developed. I think this is when George Lucas decided it really was a costume drama he was doing. Every time we saw the Queen, it ended up that she was going to have a different costume. So she ended up with 10 or 11 costumes. This is the part of the Queen Travel 1 costume. And this probably is the fabric that took the longest to make in the film. This is completely handmade on a type of fabric called it's a dissolvable fabric. So you start with a sheet of almost clear, it's like a cellophane. You do your design on it and then, and when you finish that, you stick it in water and the clear fabric disappears, leaving the lace. So this fabric, which we used here and on the sleeves, quite a small amount, as you can see, took someone probably a month to make, working at continually. I think this piece, we use quite a lot of antique pieces in various places, antique trimming and fabrics from various parts of the world. This, I think, probably was about 1910. But it was quite difficult to tell just because it was a lace piece with sort of odd bits of motifs. Some of them weren't complete and we sort of utilised them by sort of cutting them in half or using an edge. Yes, some of the motifs weren't complete, so we sort of used them, cut bits off them and then used small pieces, the bits that we only had a small bit of just in odd spots there. We sort of used every bit of it, in fact, because it was so beautiful. We cut the sort of edges off, and this piece down here probably started off in 3-inch lengths by the you know, when we started with it. And we had some fantastic sort of embroiderers here who managed to bead it all back and add in the beads to make it look like one complete piece. We then used for his sort of body costume part, a sort of a rubber with slate pieces, which was worn over the very large creature body. This was quite a time-consuming fabric to create, to make, because all the stones were gathered sort of on a beach. They are real stones, slate, little pieces of slate, and set into little slashes in the rubber, and then a rubber solution poured over the back to keep them in place. We did have problems with this in Tunisia because with the heat, the rubber sort of expanded slightly and we had stones popping out all over the place and spent quite a lot of time having to put them back in again. Well, I think the very first film was ageless, and I think George Lucas wanted this film to also be ageless, and we have really, in a very big way, actually avoided futuristic costumes. We don't really have any spacemen or type of costumes. We haven't introduced that very futuristic science fiction type of costume into this. Everything in some way has, it might be a very tenuous link back to a historical reference at some point in some place in the world. Clothing that's made for filming, particularly period clothing, has to be much stronger than real costume, real clothing. There are lots of techniques, costume techniques. You have to think of actors moving arms. We cut sleeves in a different way. We have to look at what the actors are doing in those costumes. Everything was great fun, really, because there was such a wide variety of things to do. Obviously, the very elaborate costumes were fantastic fun to do. Things like armour was great fun to do because we made up prototypes and we changed them, and we also utilised modern things that we... Anakin's pod helmet, for instance, is based on a bicycle, a children's bicycle helmet. We sort of started off from there and built on that. I can't really say that there's anything that was more fun than anything else, because the whole thing was great fun.
I went to London and discovered what a real costume designer does, which is take a box of fabrics, take 20 different fabrics, go, and next thing you know, there they all are, and they're pinned up, and it's a sheet of black just like you drew, but it's, you know, 10 different pieces of material, and they all catch the light in a different way, and it was just gorgeous. You basically take the screenplay and the written word, if you get to read it, or a verbal description from the director, if you don't, and imagine it for the director in as many different forms as he cares to see. The designs are a little more outlandish, especially for the Queen. We looked all over, I mean, Mongolia and Tibet and just everywhere to find inspiration for our costumes. And, you know, there's some very goofy hairstyles in here. George has a bad rap for giving those cinnamon buns to Princess Leia, so I think he's up for the firing squad for this one. George said that this film is definitely a costume drama, you know, and the last one wasn't, even though it was a period science fiction piece. It was still pretty recognizable, you know, Earth-style costumes. This is 40 years before, and it's a time more similar to 100 or 200 years ago here. You know, things are Art Nouveau, they're well designed, they're thought of, people had tailors, you know. So yeah, he is taking a risk. It's the first time I think he's ever done a real costume drama like this. Quite a few years ago, up at Skywalker Ranch, they started this art department to concept design from... Even back then, there was no screenplay, or if there was, we hadn't read it. It was verbally given to us. And everything was very wide open. You know, you could really come up with anything you felt like drawing that day. And somehow it seemed to fit in. The joke was always, if we couldn't figure it out, it was a senator. I went to Coruscant. But out of that sort of came the costume design, because I didn't really set out to design these costumes. It was more, George seemed to like what I was putting on people, so I just kept doing that. It was really my excuse just to draw people's faces that were going to be in this film. I love to actually capture the likeness of the character and stuff. And I find that the costume design is a lot better if you know who the face is, or even if you put a real face there. I mean, you don't dress the same way I do, and it's because of how you look and who you are and everything else. So I would choose a face, like Natalie. I chose Natalie Portman a long time ago, before she was cast, and just stuck her on there, and the costume kind of grew out of her face. And eventually I just ended up doing more and more of that until I was designing most of the costumes. And then Tricia was brought aboard, and she's the one who takes drawings where it's easy to do anything and has to make them real. So she came over from London, spent some time here. We went through a lot of the drawings, a lot of the books, talked about how my outrageous shoulders could actually be made, and she helped me make a lot of adaptations and stuff.
And when I initially saw the designs, I was like, wow, I have to do this, because you could see how much, there's so much more that goes into it than just a regular movie. There's so many people working on it and designing it and really creating. It's a really, you feel that the movie's really a creation. It's a lot of artists coming together and working on it. It's not just, you know, a script and a couple of actors. Well, being in the costumes themselves and having the strange makeup and hair really made me feel different. You feel like a different person. When you feel like a different person, it's easier to act like a different person. And there, it also changes your movement. If you've got a big thing on your head, you have to walk straighter. You can't, you know, slouch like an American teenager. You have to stand straight like a queen so that it doesn't knock you over. And you've got these huge dresses that you have to walk slowly and be careful where you stand and watch that your train doesn't get caught somewhere, and it really makes you much more conscious of your movement, which is good for a queen. But it's good for like the effect of the film, as long as it doesn't like give me brain damage or anything, I'm all for it. There's so many changes for me because a queen can't wear the same outfit twice. And I have many beautiful, beautiful costumes that were designed by the costume designers of the film. And they're just beautiful, elaborate costumes that are inspired by ancient civilization costumes. And they're really beautiful fabrics and colors and just really big and queen-like. I think that playing the queen would be inspiring, you know, to young girls, because she's very powerful and she is in control of everyone, yet she's a very good leader. She's very considerate of the people around her and has feminine traits that would make her a good leader, because she's compassionate and cares about the people around her and cares about her people and represents her people really well. She doesn't act for her own good and for her own quest for power. She really tries to do the best for her people. So I think it's a role model really for everyone, and it would be good for young girls to see a woman or girl leading.
It was extraordinary to stand in front of the mirror with all my wardrobe on and stuff. Because I was Obi-Wan Kenobi, you know, and it was quite a moment for a young man.
The look of the costumes, like, taps into all these various cultures that we all subliminally recognize, you know? It's very clever.
This is where we're going to get killed the most, or I'm going to get killed. I have very scrupulously avoided fashion in the other movies. I made the Princess Leia, you know, very, very simple, just completely simple. No design, no fashion, no nothing. This time we're walking right into a fashion statement, head on.
Okay, some suggestions for some of those new costumes.
Ooh, are we getting... Now, this is... I like the idea.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it needs to be tighter. It's this line.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If you could make that line more like this.
Mm-hmm.
So this is her battle attire?
Remember, I took one of those off that side. This will actually flap back and, you know, hook onto something at the side there. It has a little loop on the side of her trousers for the gun belt to be held down there.
The ski pant outfit.
Yeah.
I just think the grey costumes. I think Ewan looks fantastic in his.
You look good in yours. You look fantastic.
Nothing. You're braver than I thought.
Interest in the common good.
That is something I cannot do.
Padme, clean this droid up as best you can.
You're thinking, you're the people gonna die?
People of action. I suggest new leadership is needed.
We must do something quickly to stop the Federation.
I will take back what's ours.
They will elect a new chancellor.
Dean, what's happening?
Assurances. It will be ratified by the Senate.
I will sign no treaty, Senator.
Now, Your Highness. In time, the...
It is clear to me now.
Padme, Your Highness.
I'll send Padme on an... We will tell her for you. We assure her how it goes with you.
Need to rely on negotiation.
Negotiation? You to sign the treaty.
I agree. Still have much to learn, my young apprentice.
We'll need to free...
If I give you, say, 2 meters to doing the yellow,
yeah.
And maybe 6 meters to do, you know, maybe 4 meters to start with in the yellow going to pink.
has to be higher up,
right,
pinned higher up than it was.
Okay, you can drop that.
Because we had the fabric puffing out.
Of, yeah.
Chorus of guards. Right, okay. Thanks, I'll let Pops know about it. They'll have the gun.
But this hairdo isn't too close to her hairdo without, so.
Yeah, she's cool. The metal section.
These pins are through.
But like the idea of being able to see through it.
Yes, well it is lovely, isn't it? And we decided 4 inches extra on the leg.
On the back, yes.
So that was...
And I think that's still fine. I think 4 inches on the centre backs.
Yeah. And we just need a bit more.
What would happen if we let that be black in there? Would that work? Okay. See what Ian thinks. But
well, we can let you have a look at black here now.
Yeah, but I mean, just as a line, it. So this is red, and then this is red, and this would be red.
Yeah.
Pretty intense. You may want to make that.
Is an inch and a half wide.
So an inch and a half down from that mark and
four and a quarter inches across.
Yeah.
That's okay. But I think until you've actually got your supports on, we shouldn't make holes in this.
No.
And B, we shouldn't get the channels into the corset.
No.
So that was a mark in the last fitting.
Right.
So we've moved it up an inch and a half again.
Yeah. Was that mark the centre of...
Yeah.
Yeah. So we've moved that up another inch and a half.
Yeah.
Let's cover it up for now.
Okay.
Look at it.
Excuse me. There are lines there now. I think that's the lines.
Now the other thing, I thought that collar was meant to be slightly set back there.
Yeah.
So that we see into...
It is a little close to your eyes as you go.
That's quite flexible, isn't it? Yeah. I mean, in terms of, like, you could, as you were putting it on.
Just...
Would it not be if we had a smaller, you know, had that as a smaller piece and then had another piece here that was attached on the side there, that would hold that piece down? You know, on the bend of the foot?
Yes.
The reverse studs.
To go.
To go underneath. To
yeah.
Right.
Okay. The only thing I would say is about if there's a belt shape that you can sort out this evening and send
facts back to you. So, but most of that will disappear anyway, yeah. Underneath, depending yeah. on how fat.
Yeah, yeah. And the music.
And we've done two versions of this armour in different types of quilting to look mm-hmm. at. Just if you have. I mean, I like both of them. I think they're both nice. It would just be a matter of.
Going down here, you are presumably wearing boots.
Yeah.
You've got gloves. That thing on your head is perhaps a hat.
Because
I'm going to say you've got a belt, and I'm giving you soldier armor.
For a
It's a jacket. There's some webbing involved in there, and there's some gloves and a hat. Goggles and boots. We probably sent them to Tunisia. And a coat. That's the lot, I think.
Righty, huh?
It'll do me, thank you very much.
Just turn slightly, just a little bit, and then look back to me.
Isn't it?
I love the business about going to fashion shows to pick up absurd and practical things, but only turn.
George said that this film is definitely a costume drama, especially for the Queen. We looked all over to find inspiration for her costumes, and I mean Mongolia and Tibet and just everywhere.
Mm.
Okay, some suggestions for some of those new things.
This is in the right direction.
Okay.
If you could make that line more like this.
Mm-hmm.
I am nervous about all of the costumes actually working. I was paranoid until I went to London and discovered what a real costume designer does. The baton has passed to her. What was drawn now has to be made real. She's going to make it happen.
Say 2 meters in the yellow going to pink. Would that be?
Okay.
We started off originally with only 5 costumes for the Queen. By the time we actually started filming, I think we'd increased that to 10 or 11 costumes. And I don't think we see her twice in the same costume throughout the whole film. Because we're filming outside, we wanted a fabric that would move in a breeze, so we would have the breeze rippling through the top layers of her cloak.
It's got to be about 250 petals on here now, and it'll probably be about a total of a couple of days shooting. So we do all this work, and it's only for about 2 days.
What is this part of the coat, I think? But I've made red.
I think that would be safer being part of the underdress in a way.
I very scrupulously avoided fashion in the first 3 movies. I got around it. I just avoided it. But I'm discovering more and more on this one. You know, I walked right into fashion on this one, and I have not balked, so I'm going to be faced with it. It'll be very interesting to see what happens. So this is red, and then this is red. It's pretty intense.
Now, the major change from talking to George last night, quite like this dress, to be an absolute cross-cut tube dress.
Oh, right. Without,
so that is a sort of major, without any fullness. So it's quite slinky. But I think you quite like the idea of being able to see through it.
Yes, well, it is lovely, isn't it?
Yeah. I've asked if George could come at the end of lunch and have a look at it, so that you can just sort of see it before we get it completely finished.
Yeah.
Mike, could you maybe hold this for me?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Just drop that down a bit.
Yep, I think that looks good. Very good.
We got the effect that George wanted, which was a wedding dress that would be symbolic of happiness, possibly an ongoing relationship, perhaps. We're now about 4 or 5 weeks from the end of filming. We're still working and making costumes to be used next week, the week after.
And again,
if you wouldn't mind. We made well over 1,000 costumes.